people didn't know you. If they just looked at the lyrics, read the lyrics, and listened to the music, they think, wow, these guys are pretty heavy and serious. But in real life, you're not.
Right. Well, it'd be pretty boring if we were, like, all uptight all the time. I don't know. We just, that kind of, just how it works. It's not really thought out, you know?
Why would you be like that all the time? What would you be like, Danzig, just angry, punching kids in the face all the time? A lot of the stuff's kind of funny to us, but then other people don't perceive it the same way, so they kind of, you know, oh, ooh, that's, mm-hmm. you know, but to us, by the time it comes out, it's pretty funny. I feel so alone.
Did really well when it came out right away, better than Facelift.
Yeah.
But Facelift has really sort of gathered momentum, and more so even with the release of Dirt.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you feel right now about the albums?
They're round.
No.
If you feel them, they're round. Like you can feel them.
They're round and smooth and shiny.
You
see yourself.
Too.
You can see yourself.
It's cool. I mean, we're having a good time. It's kind of unexpected, actually. You know, we thought it would do good, but we didn't think it'd do this good.
I thought something very specific, didn't I?
We didn't think it'd be that nifty and neato, but with Seattle being so peachy keen and such a trendy, hip, swinging place nowadays, no wonder.
Are you happy with the success you've had so far? Is it important to you to go further? Are you hoping this album will keep going and going and going?
Yeah.
It's doing well.
It'll do whatever it does. I don't give a shit what it does.
It'll appeal to who it appeals
to. I hope
to,
it does well, and it's doing better than
we made the
I
record
thought.
For ourselves.
And the first
much,
record
you know?
Did better than we thought,
and you
too.
Thought you would, it would?
Yeah, so...
Gain momentum, I said.
Yeah, so whatever happens with it is what everybody else did. I mean, we did our thing, we did our part, and we'll go play.
How did you guys hook up with Cameron Crowe?
Well, he lives up in that area. He's married to Nancy from Heart, and our manager Kelly has a lot of history with Heart and stuff. So he didn't make that one. He didn't make that one. Anyway, we just kind of met by hanging out up there. You know, I mean, it's not that big of a city. You know, so we ended up meeting through like our manager, meeting the Wilson sisters and Cameron. And Cameron was making this movie and. He was interested in the band from like Facelift and stuff, and wanted to hear some songs. So we demoed. We had a demo tape of about 10 songs or something that we gave him.
Thank you.
And he picked one.
Pretty good.
Picked one out. Hey, it's not bad. I used to work in a circus.
What's the best thing about the industry, about the business that you're in?
The industry? Nothing.
The industry, well,
nothing.
About the
music. We get to play. That's the best part.
Yeah.
We get to go do what we like to do 1 hour a day, but then, you know, 1 or 2 hours a day, you play, and then you spend 22 hours with just nothing to do or, you know.
What are the perks?
The perks?
Outside of playing.
You get to see sights. If you have days off, if you're not too hungover or anything.
Travel's pretty cool.
Yeah, you get...
But
it gets
old sometimes, though.
Yeah, when you get up if you want to, and you go see things, you know. And then you go around towns, you meet a lot of people, friends, and, you know.
Do you ever get tired of moving around so much? Like, it must be hard to sort of have a relationship,
really.
You know.
I thought I would.
Longer than 2 weeks.
I thought I would get,
that
like...
part of it.
I thought I'd get really tired of it. But then it's like when I go home, I go stir crazy. I can't sit in one place for a while. So, because I'm real... Anyways,
it's a love hate thing. It's like, you know, if you're sitting
you
home,
hate it
you
while you're
go
out for a while,
out,
but then as soon as you go home, you go crazy within a week. Yeah. You're like, oh, get me out of here, I gotta go somewhere.
It gets old getting into like different hotels every day and this and that. You know, it gets kind of feeling alone, like being in a massive crowd and feeling alone, that type of feeling.
Yeah.
But also at the same time, like you said, you know, you gotta move, it's in your blood, you know. It's like you've been doing it so long. If you don't do it, it's even worse, you know.
Yeah.
It's, oh, God, I gotta get out of this place.
Some, we got like a lot of big shows and some arena shows through a friend of ours, through a friend of our managers, and
we'd open up like Great White and Tesla ones and shit.
Yeah,
so
we kind of like got that out of our systems. I think the first time with Great White and Tesla, I was like dry heaving behind the bass cabinet when that was like halfway through the set after I actually realized where I was. And, After that, it's
just nothing anymore. It's so easy. You can't see anybody anyway, and it's not personal at these big shows. And you can just see, you know, see a people. Like tonight, there's what, 40,000 people. This will be the most people we ever played to. I'm scared.
Hold me.
Talking about touring, what can someone expect when you come to see you guys so much?
that.
It's better than that, you get your money's worth, huh? We have a lot of how do you say that?
Choreographed.
Corrugated.
What?
We're called choreography. Collage.
We do a lot of
calligraphy. I had a
calostomy. We have like calligraphy clinics on stage.
I had a colostomy. So it makes it hard to play drums because if the bag breaks. Ooh. But no, we have too much choreography and pyro to really, you know, we have to stay in one place because you catch your hair on.
We do a lot of the spins, you know, down on our knees.
A lot of, you know, this, and then, he raps a lot, you know, he's like, we love you people, come on, sing with me. We do a lot of begging. Beg the crowd to like us.
What inspired you to write some songs?
Mood rings. We wore a lot of mood rings. That's how we got the mood from it. Earth shoes and mood rings. Swabbies.
I think...
Life, man. Life.
Gross.
It's really weird. Unexpected of this. We thought we'd maybe sell 100,000 albums, be all happy about that, make another record. We just plan on making as many records as we can, doing our own thing.
We didn't expect to go out with three speed metal bands. We definitely didn't expect to go out with Van Halen.
But it's great. And they all treated us really great. And they all like us for our fine hairdos. They comment on our good hygiene and hair. It shits together, sticks together, stays together, loves together. A lot of free time.
So every night when you guys go out and play, is it a release in its own way?
Sometimes. Sometimes it's just boring.
It's hard to do every night, you know, but we do. We just go out and jam, and whatever happens, happens. When we play our own club shows,
That's where the release is.
That's where we do our whatever, you know, we play longer and we just fuck around.
Trade instruments.
We're not too sure what we're going to do with those, but then it just depends on the crowd and what mood we're in. But the shows here, you only get so much time, so we pretty much just don't talk much and just play as many songs as we can in 40 minutes. Well, we usually just play Inagata da Vida for 40 minutes, but
yeah.
It was like going over people's heads, you know, so we just started playing our own stuff again.
We didn't expect, you know, to chart where we did, you know, we thought maybe we'd chart down way down at the bottom,
yeah,
you know,
and
climb
and build
up,
yeah.
Kind of like we did with the first record, so to be in the top 10 right away was something we really didn't think was going to be that accessible or that accepted, you know. It was really a shock.
Well, by the end of Facelift, though, actually, I mean, yeah, I actually had some pretty good hopes for the album, you know, but you know, definitely surpassed what we even thought. But just for the fact alone that Facelift did what it did, even though it took a long time to do it, which was cool, you know, it was totally cool the way it happened. I figured all those people would be there, you know. I mean, the people who bought the album and didn't return it, which, you know, fortunately was not too many people, I figured they'd be there for the next listen, you know. For the next listen, you know, and they were, you know, so we expected that to happen, but boy, not the fucking way it did. It's pretty cool. It's kind of amazing sometimes, you know. It's like in 3 months we've done what it took us like 16 months to do last time, you know. It's pretty wild. It's a set, you know. It's a space. People will get different attitudes about you if you are something in their head, you know, as far as like if you've achieved something or you're looked at upon as being like, you know, this thing. I don't know.
People's perception of how you might have changed, you know, makes them react a certain way when they approach you, you know, before, you know, they've had a chance to see whether or not you've changed. They're just assuming you have, and so they,
right,
you know, might come at you with a different attitude, and that's sometimes awkward, but it doesn't happen too often, really.
Yeah, not too often.
With people who are friends and who are close.
Does attitudes change, I think, you know, in relationship to how well a band does or whatever, you know, I mean, those are people usually you don't really know anyway. You know, the people that really mean the most to your friends and your family and stuff, you know, they might be a little more, you know, they're more excited now than they were when you're playing in a band before, and they're like, get a job, you know, but still, you know, they're always behind you, and nobody's, you know, full of shit, you know, when somebody's full of shit and kissing your ass, and that's something that we've never really been big on, you know, doing that to anybody or have it happen to us.
I don't think it's affected us, you know, in the way of thinking that we're king shit or anything, you know. Or
definitely that not that way.
You know, I think of us as exactly, you know, the same guys as when we started, but, you know, here it's just going to be a little tougher because people are unfamiliar, but that's good. I mean, you know, it gives us the incentive to go out and really bust our ass and work for it.
What's your involvement in the making of your videos?
Yeah, it depends on which video. Man in the Box, I directed. Angry Chair, I directed. Jerry's directed a couple. We basically have full involvement when we make a video.
Do you have final say in your videos?
Hell yes, we do. We have final say on the final product. Whatever comes out, it's you know, gone through us for a good month, you know, editing and re-editing and reshooting and refilming and all that. But
do you like making videos?
No, I hate it. I don't think I'm the type of guy who's supposed to be in front of a camera. You know, I don't think any of the other guys feel that they're the type of guys that should either. But, you know, you do what you gotta do.
Do you have a favorite Alice in Chains video?
My favorite is Angry Chair. The filming was you know, really interesting. We brought in all sorts of different animals and snakes and stuff that I don't like. And had them crawling all over us. And it was real relaxed shooting.
Bruce just seems to have had a bit of trouble getting airplay from what I can gather. Why do you think that is, sir, in terms of video play?
I think because the powers that be in the United States don't want the American youth to see what, or excuse me, I can't say that here, can I?
I'll probably bleep it out later.
The powers that be don't want the American youth to see what, how the United States government screwed up by doing something that was really wrong, really bad timing. And so it doesn't get played. It's something that America wants to forget, and we tried to bring it up not to stir up anything, but just because it's something that, you know, we dealt with. We've had friends that have gone to Vietnam. Jerry, his father went to Vietnam, you know, and it was a way to bring Jerry and his father back together, you know. It was a way to bond, you know, by talking about something that had really affected his father's life and his life and his family's life. And I think it was a great thing, but other people don't think so. So it doesn't get played in the United States.
Well, if you were watching the program last week, you'll know that our single of the week came from these guys, Alice in Chains, Them Bones, and it's a... Well, it gives me enormous pride and pleasure to welcome to the programme Jerry and Mike. Welcome.
Thanks.
Currently on a UK tour at the moment. How's that going? How do you find our British audiences?
Oh, it's going great, man. We're having a really good time.
Yeah, we just did two nights at the Town and Country. It was just amazing. We had a lot of fun and lots of beer.
I mean, this must be a little bit weird for you guys, because in America the album's gone platinum and you play sort of, you know, rather large auditoriums, and here you're kind of like having to start again, really, aren't you? Is that a little bit weird, or is that good?
Actually, I really don't think so, because the last time that we came with Megadeth, you know, it was definitely a lot smaller thing, and I don't think ourselves or the company really knew what to do with us, so we just kind of came over and did our thing. And this time Sony has really helped us out a lot at this time, and we've really kind of rose to the occasion with the addition of Mike, you know, coming over, and it's just been killer. So, I mean, on a European level, I think we're doing fantastic and much more than I even expected. It's really cool.
Yeah, Mike, I mean, you're sort of relatively a new boy to Alice in Chains.
New guy.
I mean, has it been easy, sort of like slotting in? What did this look like? Tell us the truth.
Well, actually, I knew him before. But they opened up for Ozzy on the 2 months on the arena tour in the States for the No More Tears album. And these guys came out. They were even touring with us before the album hit. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's a great band. We got along fine with them, you know. It was a really cool blend.
Has it been easy slotting in, though?
Yeah, it was kind of the spur of the moment. You know, I got a call, I think, New Year's night, and they said, hey, we got this gig in London, and learn these 20 songs, and we'll see you in London. Here's a plane ticket. And, you know, and here, I had four rehearsals, and five, including the one day.
The hash day.
We played everything really slow. We couldn't, it was four rehearsals, four and a half. And then we did the first gig, and then on to Germany, and here we are about 20 gigs later, and band sounded real tight, strong, and... You know, having a good time.
Jerry, what's you brought to the band that perhaps you didn't have before?
You know, Mike Starr was a great bass player, and he's also a really good friend. So it was definitely a kind of a real awkward kind of change. You know, from our point of like losing somebody that we'd started with. But what made it all cool was that we knew Mike, and you know, I mean, I can remember countless nights where I'd cruise on their bus on Ozzy and. Just kind of hang up all night playing Sega and just talking all night. Mm-hmm. But we always talked about jamming with each other. And when the decision came that we were going to let Mike go and keep going on, Mike was the first person we thought about. And, you know, at sound checks, we've been coming up with all kinds of new material and just cool jams. And it's cool. I mean, it's a different thing. Mike's a different bass player than Mike Starr. And so that's cool. It's going to add a lot of variety, I think. I think the next album is going to be really spectacular.
Hi there, and welcome back to the Headbangers Ball. The next part of tonight's show is coming to you from Lollapalooza 93. And we've come to the New Jersey concert to hook up with Alice in Chains to find out all their latest news. And as you can see, I'm joined by three of the guys. So how are you all doing? How's it going?
Very well, Vanessa. Thank you very much.
Couldn't be better, Vanessa. Thank you very much.
Now, last time we heard about you, unfortunately, you had to cancel the support slot to Metallica in Europe. And I was wondering, have you found Lollapalooza a more enjoyable experience because of the nature of the event, that the pressure isn't on you so much?
Well, the nature of the beast is always present at these shows, which is cool. You know, Satan rocks.
What's the atmosphere like backstage and stuff? Is there a lot of camaraderie between the bands?
The atmosphere is great. Usually, it's a lot of guys that look like this. Follow me. He works for the ambulance company. He rushes out into the crowd if you get hurt and saves your life. That
good.
Man does.
Very important person to have at a concert.
He wraps you in gauze. With just a little touch of lanolin for that extra burning, itching sensation.
Now, when you cancelled the Metallica support shows, was that a kind of point in your career where you had to kind of think carefully about the limits of how much you can actually do? Because before then, you'd just been constantly touring.
Oh, we were taking the time to remember how to think.
Good.
So that's the nature of that.
It's like we had to go back and do the soundtrack for the Arnold Schwarzenegger movie, Last Action Hero. So we had, you know, obligations in L.A. and in Europe. We just got back from Europe, so something had to give there, you know. So we decided to go back to L.A., finish the two songs. And they asked us to score the movie with Michael Kamen,
yes.
The guy who did The Wall and all that stuff. You know, really honored to work with them. And we just went to L.A. and drank a bunch of beer and just, you know, did the usual thing. But we stayed in one place for a while, which is a change for us, you know.
We'll talk about that a little bit later on, because we've got the video coming up for What the Hell Have I a little bit later on tonight. But are there any plans to go back to Europe this year at all?
Yeah, I think what we're planning to do is a record in spring, and I think we'll start touring in Europe. So we'll be in Europe in the spring, early summer next year.
We've got the video for Rooster on the way next. Now, although the song itself isn't very violent, Why did you feel it was necessary to have such a violent and explicit video?
We were just trying to make the video as true to the you know, storyline behind the song. It, you know, it's about real hard times, you know, during a war, and the no contact with the family and friends and loved ones, and you know, it's a serious thing. It wasn't meant to be violent or scary, but
just real.
Yeah.
And Jerry's dad is in it, so we're going to go into the video for Rooster now. Now, unfortunately, due to the war going on in the former Yugoslavia, MTV Europe has elected not to show the full version, so we're going to show you the edited version of Rooster. Chains are still with me on the Headbangers Ball. We're on location at Lollapalooza 93. And we're going to catch up with some more up-to-date happenings with Alice in Chains. And just in the last segment, we mentioned The Last Action Hero. Now, how did you get involved with that film soundtrack?
I was dating Arnold Schwarzenegger at the time, and he knew I played in a band. I don't know. How'd that happen?
We got a fax. We just got a fax, and met Arnold in this bar, and you know, I took him in arm wrestling. You know, we sat down, I just took him.
And I guess you won.
Yeah, I made him put us in the movie. So,
two out of three, he beat him. Two out of three, and Arnold was.
I eat right. Low cholesterol. You know, I got a clean colon.
But did you have to actually read the script of the film and everything to come up with the songs?
We did read the script, but basically we just wrote. You know, what came to mind, and they actually brought in some footage and it synced up, you know, with the movie. So we didn't really write the songs based around the idea of the movie, but it worked.
It's cool. We wrote the songs, and then they based the whole movie around our songs, which is really weird. First time it's ever happened, and, you know, we're just honored. I'm honored to be here. I'm out of words. I'm speechless.
It's true to this.
No, it's a great soundtrack. There's lots of really excellent bands on there.
Great soundtrack, but we're not strong swimmers. We don't swim well. We're not strong swimmers.
I can't swim.
Because Mike, you were involved with writing with Alice in Chains for the first time for those two songs, weren't you?
Yeah, it was a lot of funny. A lot of fun, but it was a lot of funny, and I couldn't remember it. But I'm sorry for whatever I did. I'm sorry. I totally apologize. And it's just a lot of fun. These guys, you know, we have a good time.
The two new songs on The Last Action Hero, are they indicative of new songs for the future of Alice in Chains, or were they kind of just one-offs?
You know, we wrote them for a certain thing, but I mean, I think it both songs show the natural progression of this band. I think by the time we do our next record, it'll have progressed so far that we will actually implode on stage.
Yeah, we will have progressed so far that we will actually start to regress, and we'll be doing Poison covers after that.
Actually,
we're
gonna. But we'll be doing.
Skinny, bop bop.
We'll do them better than Poison ever did.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, well, we've got some more music on the way. We've talked about it, and now we're going to show it to you. This is the European premiere of the first Alice in Chains song from the Last Action Hero movie soundtrack. This is What the Hell Have I? First time ever in Europe. Few of the 8 to 10,000 people, I guess, here at New Jersey. This is the third show at this location, and all nights have been sold out. And as you can see, I'm still with Alice in Chains. We've got a few more moments to talk. Just a few general things that you can answer for us. Is it true that Jerry has been writing with Chris Cornell from Soundgarden?
Jerry has written with Chris Cornell from Soundgarden a couple years ago, but I don't think.
Is he recently now?
Nobody's dating him.
Not that again.
I think you got it all wrong. I think they're dating, but you know, it's just kind of, it's a touch and go subject. I'm gonna have to leave that up to him, and he's not here. He's actually with Chris right now and sweating. You know what I mean?
Well, I think I better go to Mike here for a serious reply.
We were in Stockholm, Sweden, when we went to Europe last time, and Jerry wrote this acoustic song, sad song, and he took it back and he recorded it over at Chris's house, and him and Chris sang it, you know, together. Cool. Yeah, that's what she's talking about.
So where is that song ever going to appear? Anywhere on the Soundgarden album?
Or? You never know. It's we don't write music actually to put it out or anything. We just write, you know, it's part of us and part of our being, you know. It's not really like the songs that we wrote for the Arnold Schwarzenegger movie weren't really for the Arnold Schwarzenegger. They were just songs.
On the fourth album, when we can't come up with anything, yeah, we take all the songs we recorded in the last 3 years.
Then we're just gonna do Air Supply Metallica medleys, you know, all the time. Just Air Supply.
ABBA,
you know, they're out. They're not hip. Okay, ABBA's not hip
grunge.
Anymore.
They're not grunge.
What am I doing with that?
Lollapalooza. There you go. Well, very quickly, I guess there are something like 20 more shows to do on this tour, and then what's going to happen for Alice in Chains?
Go to Japan and Australia, and then we're going to go and hang out with duck-billed platypuses and go diving for about a month and just hang out and, you know, get in trouble. Try to get into some Australian pouch, if you know what I mean.
So all is well in the Alice in Chains camp, yeah?
Sure. How's it going at MTV over there in Europe?
It's great, thank you. Yes.
Lots of beer intake and lots of phlegm. A lot of phlegm coming up now. So we're at the point of the tour with lots of phlegm. Lots of phlegm.
All right, well, thanks very much to Alice in Chains for taking time out to talk to us at Lollapalooza 93. We're going to go into another commercial break right now, and then after that, I'll be back in the studio. But I hope you've enjoyed seeing the guys again on tour in America. So see you later.
Bye.
Headbangers Ball on location at Lollapalooza 93. We're hanging out with Alice in Chains. Tell us a little bit about the latest thing we've heard from you, which is off the Last Action Hero soundtrack.
What the hell have I?
We'll play that video in just a little bit. We'll premiere it.
That's right. We tried to make the biggest, goofiest heads we could make and play with all these big heads around, because we have really big heads.
Wait a minute. Okay. Anyways, there's also another track on the Last Action Hero soundtrack.
A little bitter,
and I like that one. It's a little heavier than the one that we've all been hearing a lot.
We like it heavy.
And from what I understand, they also let you, being now a full-fledged member of Alice in Chains, help in the writing of it.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. It's a real natural thing, you know. We just got together and just drank a lot and shut off all the phones and started jamming, you know. And it worked out well. We're here. We're rocking.
Now, what kind of stuff other than the musical talent of this guy? What other stuff is he kind of given to the band?
You gave me chlamydia, Rick.
That was the answer that we were looking for. We're going to come back and talk to Alice in Chains. We're also going to have a world premiere video, and we may even talk to this guy. Don't count on it, though. More Headbangers Ball. Headbangers Ball on location, Lollapalooza 93. We're in New Jersey. This is Alice in Chains. And now we can say that, Mike, you are officially a member of Alice in Chains now, right? Not just a fill-in kind of guy.
Yeah, I'm part of the band. I don't want to be, but they have my family held hostage back in L.A., and they won't let him loose until after Lollapalooza.
Any permanent scars already?
Actually, I went through two bases, and I'm in therapy, but I'm making progress. I'm making progress.
First of all, how did you get hooked up with the whole Lollapalooza thing?
Oh, with my fly rod, which you'll see next week at the water park.
We're going to talk about that. Next week, the Headbangers Ball is going to be on location at some wild water park. I think it's called Action Park. And we're going to be spending the whole show with Alice in Chains. We're going to find out extremely interesting things, such as
how ugly I look in a Speedo.
That's just a hint. That's just a hint. Anyway, we're going to still have a world premiere from Alice in Chains. And right now, it's time for us to play the number one video on Countdown to the Ball. Then we're going to come back and talk to Alice in Chains. We're at Lollapalooza 93. Headbangers Ball, we're at Lollapalooza 93. And what do you think about some of the other bands that are playing this show? I mean, I heard that somebody gets up on stage with you during Rooster, right?
Larry from Primus gets up and plays guitar. So that's a whole heap and load of fun.
And are there any other guys that have been, like, kind of...
Fishbone's been coming up and jamming with us, Jam Rooster, a couple times, and Jerry goes and jams with Primus all the time. He's, like, part of their band. He's going to quit our band and join Primus now.
Has it kind of been a big family, sort of, with everybody hanging out with each other and making friends?
It's kind of like a family. Everybody's got, like, extra thumbs now all of a sudden, though. I can't figure
that. And that's a scary thought.
I can't figure that part out.
Right now, we're going to world premiere a video from Alice in Chains. Tell us about this video, won't you?
That's a video? It's a video.
Tell us about the video we're about to world premiere.
Oh, it's real great. Which one are we doing?
It's yours.
Oh, it's the best.
It's better than great. It's theirs. Here is What the Hell Have I from Alice in Chains. Headbangers Ball on location at Lollapalooza 93. Want to also remind you that next week on the Headbangers Ball, we will have all these guys in their summer water attire.
Our skivvies, Rick, our skivvies.
We're going to be wearing our skivvies. We're going to be going to an action water park. We're going to be sliding down slides and
filling up our lungs full of fluid, just pretty much.
Exactly, that, and it's fun stuff. That's next week on the Headbangers Ball. Now, let's look at tonight's show as kind of a guide to Lollapalooza. Any tips you want to give to the people out there that want to come to the show?
Don't eat yellow snow.
Eat a turkey leg.
Wear a condom.
Hi, Mom.
Well, there you go. A little bit of Lollapalooza tips for you. We're going to be back with more Headbangers Ball at Lollapalooza 93. Hanging out with Allison Chains. Now, the show started probably like 5 or 6 hours ago, and then you go on. Are the crowds sometimes a little bit burnt out when you guys go on?
They're always burnt out when we play, Rick. That's what we like to believe, that the reason they're leaving is that they're burnt out.
How have the shows been so far?
Da.
The good thing I like about these interviews with Allison Chains, in the many years that we have interviewed Allison Chains, is that we always get really good, straight answers. Would you like to elaborate on that?
Straight answer.
Do that? Okay, so tell us, after the Lollapalooza shows, are you going to go on the road, or are you going to go in the studio and record a record? Here comes another straight answer.
Oh.
This is the straight generic, like, MTV's DJ guy question. Tell me, Lane, after the Lollapalooza festival, do you plan to record a new album or go back out on the road?
Well, Ricky, we plan to do a quadruple live album. And in our spare time, we're going to put out another 2 records this year. And we're going to go on tour.
What about the Alice in Chains action figures? Are there any talk about that yet?
Yeah, I've been making some of me for the chicks.
Because they dig that kind of stuff. Anyway, don't forget Alice in Chains at Lollapalooza 93 when it comes to your town. And don't forget, next week on the Headbangers Ball, to keep you in the summer mood, all of us are going to go to a water park and do the things that people do at a water park.
Yeah, that'll be a lot of fun, Rick. Lots of fun.
Lots of fun, and I'm sure that they're going to be wearing unique and unusual water attire.
Well, now you've ruined it. Now we're just going to wear basic.
You're going to have to watch
brown.
Next Saturday's Headbangers Ball. There'll be more of the Headbangers Ball coming to you from Lollapalooza 1993.
By 1993, Lollapalooza had become an established rock ritual along the lines of such European institutions as England's Reading Festival.
And the whole thing with, you know, Perry coming up with this idea, which is a great idea, it's been done before. I mean, it's recycling of a good idea, which is music is for people to get together and have a good time.
So what are your thoughts on this day that's finally arrived? How far back did you find out that you were going to do it?
We've known for about 3 months, I think.
3 months?
3 months, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
The initial excitement was just that?
Yeah, we were looking forward to doing it. It's kind of, as it's gotten more closer and stuff, you know, just kind of getting ready. Today's going to be kind of fun. Kind of interesting. We haven't played a show in a while.
Yeah, it's going to be a hell of a band practice.
You rehearsed, though? Lots?
Never.
Okay. Never?
We are tonight. We're going to rehearse in about an hour.
Rehearsal's not a real big thing with our band.
So how far into the performance will you give it a scale of 1 to 10?
We'll give it a scale of fish right now. We'll give it this fish scale. It should be really great, man. We're gonna have a good time. There's a lot of people here. The weather's really good. I heard last year that it rained.
We had an instant fog machine.
Oh, okay.
That came back onto the stage. will you throw out certain tunes? Some tunes will be there. Some tunes gotta be there.
Well, we pretty much, you know, spread it out of both the albums and stuff. I think
we're winging it.
What do you open with?
What are we opening with today?
River.
In that river today.
What do you close with?
We close with Rooster.
Close with Rooster today.
Do we have a new video for you?
Actually, we just shot a video for What the Hell Have I, one of the songs for the Arnold Schwarzenegger flick. And I think that's
Ani.
I think that's in the stores right now, and I think the movie's going to be out probably within about a week.
It's up today.
Oh, is it?
What was the feedback to the video? Rooster that went gave us all that footage. We're Canadians. We didn't go through that same war experience as you did, but it still impacted us a great deal.
Screwed us. They wouldn't play it because they said it affected a lot of people. They'll show like guys smoking crack and shooting each other with machine guns, but they won't play like a Vietnam video or anything. So.
Well, that didn't really happen.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. It's not real.
I mean, they played it a few times, but then they said people were disturbed.
Well, we played it a lot. We just said off the front of the video, this is not your normal video. This has a statement to make. This is about war.
Right. Right.
And the horror of war.
Right. Yeah, definitely.
And I mean, then we played it.
I mean, you know, MTV did give it a shot, but like Sean said, you know, it just kind of, I guess, it disturbed people or whatever.
Headbangers Ball is on location in Germany tonight. We're at the Frankfurt Musikhalle, and we are dedicating the show to Alice in Chains. And right now I'm joined by Jerry and Mike, number two, new bassist, Mike.
So, number two.
Welcome to you guys.
I like it.
You played your first, the opening night of the tour in Bonn last night. So how did that work out for you?
It was a good gig.
Yes.
Mike, number two.
Lots of fun.
We just got to change your name, man. Yeah. Mike, well, number two.
Or spell star with three R's.
Three R's, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, it was a great gig. You know, we did that, did a little warm-up thing at the Underground, and that was cool. This music is so bad, folks. Don't ever try to play this at all.
This is a sound check going on in the background, so you will be hearing a fair bit of noise going on there. Now, obvious question, what happened with the departure of Mike Starr? Why did he leave the band?
Well, Mike just decided to take some time, you know, and kind of go and do his own thing. And we wanted to keep touring and keep going, you know, so the obvious choice was to find somebody that we could work with or we, you know, thought we could deal with. And we toured with Mikey for like 2 months with
Ozzy.
Right. Yeah, so we got along really good. And,
but was it because...
We snagged him.
Mike number two. You had very little time to get integrated into the band because you were playing with Ozzy right up to like a couple of weeks ago, weren't you?
We were actually working in the studio with Ozzy Riding in Reno, Nevada up until the day I got on a plane to come over here. I had like about a week to learn the songs. We had, four rehearsals?
Four.
Yikes.
And then we played the first gig and it went good. We had a lot of fun, you know.
So you're going to be using sound checks to get Mike integrated more into the band?
Well, he's pretty much got it down already, so... sound checks is kind of, you know, I'm sure over the next couple of weeks it's going to get a lot tighter, but it's fine now. It's great.
So are you going to see how it works out with Mike, number two, before you, is he going to be like a permanent member, or what's happening there? Can you say?
He's temporary help at this point. No, I mean, you know, we'll just see how it goes. I mean, you know, doing this job, you spend a lot of time together, so, you know, it's a lot for Mike to think about, you know, because he's still doing some things with Ozzy, and it's a lot for us to think about taking a new guy on, because, you know, shit, we've been together for 5 years, so, you know, it takes time. I'm sure it'll work out, but it's just going to take doing it and see how it works out, you know.
All right, well, we've got the video for Wood on the way now, and of course you can find it on the album Dirt and also on the singles movie soundtrack. I was wondering, is that song, is the title a play on the name of Andrew Wood?
Yeah.
Was that how you came up with the idea?
Yeah.
But spelled differently.
Well,
with a question mark.
It's not literally about Andy, but it's kind of a play on the situation surrounding his death, you know, and just how ridiculous people act and how righteous and uppity people can get, you know, about how somebody lives their life or leaves this life, whatever, you know. Everybody has got their own trip, you know, and they should be able to follow whatever they want to do. I'm not condoning anything. I'm just, you know, pointing fingers doesn't work. You know, you should take a look in the mirror before you start pointing a finger at somebody else. That's what the song's about.
Did you find it therapeutic to write that song in terms of, like, dealing with his death?
It was a friend of mine, you know? I mean, it's something I felt like writing at the time, so I wrote it, you know?
Well, let's see the video now. We're going to see Alice in Chains, and let's dedicate this song to Andrew Wood. Alice in Chains of Wood. On the Headbangers Ball, Alice in Chains special, and more great music on the way, but gonna talk to Jerry a little bit about some of the earlier history of Alice in Chains. And in fact, we've got a viewer's question coming up, and this comes from Kate O'Malley in Ireland, who sent in loads of really great questions, actually, so I think she's a real fan. She knows a lot about you. She would like to ask, are you pleased that because Facelift was released a long while before the media sort of hyped up this Seattle scene, that it managed to establish Alice in Chains into more of a cult status type of band rather than sort of being overexposed?
Well, I mean, how it happened was definitely cool. You know, you can't really plan those type of things anyway, one way or the other. You know, it just kind of put the music out and go for it, you know, see who wants to listen to it. And fortunately, everybody picked up on it, you know, and it took a while, and it did it at a nice steady pace, you know, so it wasn't really kind of like here to here, you know, mm-hmm. So that was kind of nice, you know, give you kind of a little bit of time to acclimate yourself, you know, kind of get used to the whole deal, but I'm really happy how things have worked out.
Good, absolutely. A lot of viewers also wanted to know how you actually came up with the name Alice in Chains. Some viewers feel that it might be a reference to drugs, that the Alice is like the fantasy side of things, like Alice in Wonderland, and that the change is like not being able to get out of a situation.
Nope.
So the answer is no. So how who came up with the name and how?
It was a joke. Lane had the name a long time ago before we were even a band. And, the idea was to, just like a drunken joke, basically. I mean, the idea was to get a band together and play like Slayer covers and wear dresses and makeup and shit.
That sounds fun.
Yeah, so that's where the name came from.
Right. In the early days, did you experiment a lot with your image and your musical styles?
Yeah, you experiment with a lot of things, you know, not just music, you know. You got to find who you are, and you do what you do to do that, you know. Mm-hmm. Do what you do to do that. Do-do. Yeah, I mean. Yeah.
Yeah, you did. Okay. Okay, we're moving on to talk about the new album, Dirt, on this Alice in Chains special from Frankfurt. And right now, I'm joined by Lane, and Jerry is still here as well. And I was going to start off by asking you, some of the songs on Dirt date back to 1990. I was wondering, did it help you to road test them first? And have they been updated in any way by the time they reached the album?
We played a couple of them. I don't think we only played Dirt and Rooster.
Mm-hmm.
That's all we're really playing live.
Sure. Danke.
I don't know, we didn't really think about it too much, you know, as far as like, we don't think, basically, is what I'm saying.
It's not one of my strong points, thinking.
But a lot of bands actually welcome the opportunity to try the songs out in front of a live audience. So I guess you...
We usually try them out, you know, before we record them.
Because, I mean, they were almost...
Before the album's released, we'll go out and try them out.
Because they were written around the time of Facelift then, I guess.
No, just a couple songs.
Right. Okay.
Most of it's pretty new.
Do you feel that your songs reveal a lot about you as people? If somebody really looked at the lyrics and...
I don't think so. I mean, it's a part. It's a moment in time, you know? It's not like a whole book or anything. It's just a glimpse, a little look, you know?
But obviously it's a way of like expressing yourselves.
Sure.
If you didn't express yourself that way, how do you think you might? Could you get into like writing poetry or, you know, getting into other sort of things like that?
I don't really think about it a whole lot. This is what I do it, so that's what, you know, I found my calling.
Well, you're very lucky.
Yeah, I am.
A lot of people don't find their calling in life. It's tough, isn't it?
I am.
Okay, well, we're going to talk to the guys from Alice in Chains lots more, but right now we've got our first commercial break coming up, and actually playing us into the break, we're going to show you a little bit of Alice in Chains live on stage here at the Musikhalle in Frankfurt, and then we'll be back a little bit later on, so stay tuned.
Germany with Alice in Chains, and Elaine is still with me, and now I'm very pleased to say hello to Sean. So welcome to you. How are you doing, Sean?
I'm doing fine.
Yes? There's a screaming trees soundtrack going on in the background, so it may be a little bit noisy.
Screaming trees!
A lot of viewers have been asking about the SAP EP. Why did you decide to release it, and how did you come up with the name?
Sean.
Well, Sean. Won't tell ya. Kids. SAP. Sappy songs. Acoustic songs. I had a dream. A vision. I'm a visionary. I'm way ahead of my time.
So that's a true story then?
That's a true story.
Do you think that a true definition of the Seattle scene is not really the type of music that is coming out there, but more of the fact that there seems to be like a lot of camaraderie and friendship and like respect between the bands?
It's that, and I think it's actually the main part is the fashion statement. It's not really the music, it's just the flannel shirts and cutoffs that it really put it over the top, you know. It's kind of a fashion thing. We're all fashion whores.
But it
in
seems
Seattle.
That, you know, on the SAP EP you had some special guests, and I know that, you know.
I think it was like that, you know. Yeah. That's what started, you know, what made it special to come out, you know, and break out of that certain city or town, you know, at a certain time. I don't think it's the same way now. Now I think it's everyone's trying to ride on everyone else's coattails.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
You know, but at the time when we got our record deal and Soundgarden and Mother Love Bone got their record deals, you know, that's the way it was, you know. It was a real incestuous type of scene, you know.
It must have been great to have been part of that, because it's obviously going to go down in, like, rock history.
I think.
I slept with Chris Cornell.
I slept with Stone.
He was
like 2 minutes of pure manhood.
Pure loving. Stone Gossard, 2 minutes of just.
Well, I'm trying to maintain the seriousness of this interview. Now, you guys actually started recording the Dirt album in Los Angeles just around the time of the riots. So I was wondering, did that affect you in any way?
We couldn't go to the studio.
Well, when I got stuck in Compton in my car in the middle
really?
Of traffic, yeah. It was me and my girlfriend and a lot of black people.
Very frightening.
Very, very frightening.
It was like a war.
Yeah.
I mean, they were shooting everybody and burning everything, and it was really pretty wild.
Every three blocks there was just a bank on fire. It was insane.
The only thing that sucked is the day that we first started tracking and recording, and then that day it happened, so it kind of, we had to wait a week. We couldn't go back to the studio and had to leave town. And
we went out to the desert and took peyote with Tom from Slayer.
Didn't affect you in any way?
I mean,
when you went back to record, knowing that all that had gone on?
Slightly. I mean, you just couldn't believe that people were that stupid.
There was a lot of
each other and making, you know, it's really stupid.
Absolutely.
There was that, and there was the earthquakes, you know, so there was so many interruptions during our recording. It wasn't consistent, really.
Okay, well, we're going to go into a Van Halen video now, and you guys have actually toured with Van Halen in the States, haven't you?
Slept with Eddie Van Halen, too.
Elaine and Sean are still with me on the Headbangers Ball, and we're going to talk a little bit more about the songs on Dirt. Most of your songs seem to deal with the darker side of life. Do you find it easier to write from that perspective?
Yes.
You do.
He's evil. He's the evil one. Satan and whole bit.
No, I didn't mean that.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You seem to be very preoccupied with death. Why is that? Are you very? Is it?
Because I'm alive still.
Yes, but if you are aware of your own mortality, doesn't that mean that you make the most of every single day, and that I think it's kind of a good way to be aware of that.
It's a good thing. I don't think we just.
You don't dwell on it.
I don't think we dwell on it. Just, but you know, those issues come up with everyone. I think. I mean, if they don't come up, then. I mean. if darker issues or, you know, or pain or sadness doesn't ever come up out of someone, I think they've got to be pretty phony or pretty plastic and fooling themselves, you know. And you got to deal with those emotions somehow.
Absolutely.
And this is the way to deal with them for me.
Right. I mean, can you in any way relate to bands like Def Leppard and Motley Crue who tend to just deal with
all.
The lighter side of life?
Not at all. Yeah.
Girls.
Yeah, girls,
we're
cars.
We're just in it for the girls, you know, basically. So that's all I'm here for, is to meet all the women I can and sleep with as many women as I can, because I'm invincible against AIDS.
Mopar rules!
I just want to ride a Harley and bag a bunch of babes. That's all I want to do.
I mean, a lot of attention has been drawn to the fact that five of the songs on the album are, you know, related to kind of drug abuse, but to me they seem to tell a story. Was it important to you that listeners appreciate like the bigger picture and not just take like an individual song and dissect that?
Yeah, I mean that's the way they were written, you know, in succession with each other, you know. So I definitely wanted them all put together and read that way and listened to that way.
Mm-hmm. So there's a positive message really in the final song.
I think so.
Angry Chair, that you've come through something. And
without preaching to someone, I mean, it's just, you know, my views. I think it's important.
Good. All right then. Your very first EP in the States was We Die Young. I don't think it was ever released in Europe, but we're going to see, obviously you can also find that track on Facebook, we're going to see the video for We Die Young. Kane and Sean are still with me on the Headbangers Ball, and we're going to talk a little bit more. And actually, a little earlier we saw the video for We Die Young, which is quite a sinister and scary video. I was wondering, how much are you involved in the concept of actually what the videos are going to look like, and do you enjoy making videos?
100% and no.
100% involved, but you don't enjoy making them.
That is correct. Yes, you are correct.
It is sort of weird. Something you have to do nowadays.
It's tiring, you know.
Faking your song over and over and over to a room full of strangers is pretty grating, actually. I hate it. And I'm the drummer, so I'm not in the videos. So I'm just going to go there and hang out with these guys while they're in them all day.
And I guess another thing is...
You get free catering.
I get free catering. I get a meal, and I get to stand in a room, a cold room, for 12 hours.
Yeah, and there might be a few girls there as well.
Well, you know, that's why I go. I get my hair all styled up, and I go there, and I pretty much try to work the ladies,
but,
because I rock.
Also, I guess one of the problems with making videos is actually translating your ideas to a video director, and then, you know, a lot of bands, when they finally see the finished product, they say, oh, we didn't really want that, but it's just getting your ideas across.
Yeah.
Well, it's worked.
You just gotta go through a lot of tapes and find guys that you like.
Four out of five times it's worked.
Yeah.
Yeah?
We work with the same guys a lot, or, you know, a few times.
Is that Matt Mahurin that you've worked with recently?
I've worked with him once. And this guy named Rocky Shank, he did with Them Bones and We Die Young, and shot both the album covers and band pictures. We work with him a lot. He's a great friend. Love you, babe.
What's cool about your videos is that they don't actually explain the song. They leave that open to interpretation by the person watching.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's pretty good. Yes, okay. I was wondering, just talking a little bit about the artwork on both Facelift and Dirt, is there any connection between them? Because Facelift had like a face, and Dirt has also got like a child's, young woman's face on it. Is there any connection?
None whatsoever.
No? They're
two separate entities, their own minds.
Yes? What's the mind of Dirt then?
It's a mind of a 13-year-old.
13-year-old with a dirty mind.
Little boy, whacking.
Greased up, lathered up.
To his dad's dirty mags. I'm combing my hair! You know, he's hiding in the bathroom with the door locked, telling his mom he's combing his hair when he's really, you know. That's what it's all about.
Slapping the dolphin.
Not.
Huh?
Not.
It is, too.
Well, you've just disillusioned quite a few thousand people out there. Things are hotting up here. There's a sound check going on. There's a bit of a party happening over there. So you'll have to excuse the background noise, but Lane and Sean are still with me. And question for Lane, actually. It seems to me that you and Jerry are sharing things more, and as much as Jerry is taking some lead vocals, you've taken over a bit of guitar. Do you find that that enables you to help take the pressure off each other?
Yeah, I think it took a lot of pressure off, as opposed to Facelift, when we pretty much relied on Jerry to write everything. And if we didn't like something, you know, he would get frustrated, but then we didn't offer our services in writing, you know. And this time everyone, you know, brought in riffs and, you know, helped out and made it a lot easier on all of us.
Did you play any guitar on the album?
Yep.
Boy, did you play some guitar.
I did a couple tweedly deedlies and some.
He might do a solo tonight.
Why? So, I mean,
yeah?
You never know. I mean, the guy.
Watch out for that.
It's a hidden talent.
We want to kill.
Watch out, Inbe!
Is Jerry actually helping you with your technique at all? Or?
Well, if he had a technique, I'd ask him for help, but.
You were just doing it your own way?
No, I'm doing it Sean's way. He's like, he's good on drums, but you should see this guy with an axe.
I mean, I can.
Can you play the guitar as well?
Oh, yeah. I'm a wizard.
Yeah?
Yeah.
For real?
Look out, yeah. Nuno.
I can. Nuno Bettencourt.
No, Nuno.
I'll be an extreme in just a couple of weeks.
This is quite an interesting question, I hope. You agree, coming up next. It seems that a lot of the vocal arrangements are like very choral on the album. Have any of you kind of studied music?
I was in the Vienna Boys Choir when I was in.
Why do I keep having to say not as far as Sean's concerned?
I was in the Boys Choir. What? See? They know I was.
I mean, was it important to you that the songs at first glance were like still very simple and immediate, even though some of them had quite complicated arrangements?
Yeah, I don't know. Writing has never been a difficult thing. It hasn't ever been thought out or anything. It just comes to us. None of us have really had any musical training. I played trumpet when I was in fifth grade, but I don't think.
But you don't want to admit to that, do you?
Well, I just did, didn't I?
You should hear him on the accordion, huh? He can really.
I play the bagpipes too.
So songwriting comes easily to you. It's not like a process of like tearing your hair out or.
No, I mean if it doesn't come easy, we just put the paper down, put the instruments down,
right.
Try it another day.
We were saying a little bit earlier that you toured the United States with Van Halen, and you have toured with lots of bands of various different styles. Do you think that's indicative of the fact that Alice in Chains' music crosses a lot of boundaries, that you can support lots of different artists?
That could be part of it. It could be that we're not in the... We'll play with anybody, so... And people we like, you know. We liked Van Halen when we were growing up, some of us, so it was an honor. It's not, the musical wasn't the same, and the crowd was kind of eating a lot of popcorn and when we were playing, but we're
Screaming
not there.
Trees playing Working Man by Rush.
Yeah.
That's scary.
We just like to play, so.
Because you got on with Eddie Van Halen really well in particular, didn't you?
Yeah, those guys are great guys.
Well, we're going to take another short break on this special edition of the Headbangers Ball from Frankfurt with Alice in Chains. But stay tuned because we'll be talking to the guys a lot more right after these messages. Alice in Chains with Them Bones. And Jerry has joined myself and Lane on the Headbangers Ball. And I was talking to Lane a little bit earlier about how the songs deal with the darker side of life. I'd like to get Jerry's perspective on that. Do you find it easier to write from the darker side of the sort of that perspective?
I really don't think about it a whole lot. I mean, I guess it is because that's the type of music I write.
But it seems that in some ways you're preoccupied with death. Is that true?
I'm not preoccupied with death any more than anybody else. Just I don't use death literally in the things that I write either. I mean, I use it symbolically a lot. Death can be an end, you know, mm-hmm. and for a new beginning to start, you know, whatever. it's not always a literal term, but it's a pretty good concrete word to use to get a point across.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely.
And so, you know, that's the kind of stuff that I kind of dig a little bit more, is things that are a little more harsh, and to the point, instead of kind of sugar-coated. You know, mm-hmm. I'm not really into that. You know,
right. But
I kind of grew out of that when I was 17 or 18. You know.
But I was saying to Lane that if you are aware of your kind of your own mortality, that kind of enables you to make the most of your life and to live every day to the full. Well, is there an element of that in there?
Everybody's got to realize that, you know, you have no control over, you know, when you're going to not be around anymore, you know. So that's the thing that everybody runs from in their entire life, you know, and try to do the things that you'd like to do in life. Do them as well as possible. Mm-hmm. It's the way it is for me.
Well, that's a very positive message in itself.
Sure.
Yeah. I asked you a little earlier how much the songs revealed about you as people. I mean, obviously your lives and your backgrounds have influenced you to some degree. Do you think that as you become more successful, your lives are going to become a lot easier in some ways? And do you find that a little bit ironic in some ways?
I think it was easier when I was really struggling hard. I think the easier it gets in some ways, the harder it gets in others. I mean, the more of your time that's demanded, you know, of you, the more that's expected of you, are all the things that come with success. And
it's a lot more work.
Yeah, hell of a lot more.
Yeah.
I was told there was to be no work involved in this career.
You know, when you're on tour, especially, that's a real physical thing.
Yeah.
You know, it's
kind of get into like robot mode.
Tour mode.
Yeah. I mean, everything kind of looks the same and feels the same, and you kind of have to put yourself in that mental state to deal with all this. I mean, because you're on the road for year and a half or 2 years at a time, and maybe there's a month break in that whole year and a half.
Yeah. I can imagine. Is it difficult to adjust when you do go home?
Oh yeah.
You have a week where you're like,
Oh, even longer sometimes. Yeah. You get really burned out and tired.
It's a shock.
It is. It's like, I mean, you know, you could be totally, completely thrashed from touring, you know, go home and sit in your room and like, okay, I'm watching my fish now, okay, I'm smoking a cigarette, I'm watching TV, what do I do? And it's and then you want to get right back out on the road.
Yeah,
you know?
I can appreciate that.
But, I mean, it's nice to go home, you know, do that, but it takes a while to mellow out.
Okay.
Get out of the old routines.
Okay. I'd like to talk a little bit about Angry Chair, that particular song. We've got an exclusive showing of the video on the way in just a moment. I was talking to Lane a little bit earlier about how the five songs relating to drugs seem to tell a story, and Angry Chair kind of concludes that story. Why did you decide to end the song there? Because it kind of could have gone on to when the fact that there's always going to be a temptation.
Well,
end the story.
That song is written completely about that temptation still being there.
Right.
And so I think it's a good place to end it, leaving the fictitious character open to make, you know, mistakes later on, and not laying down the law saying, you know, I've learned it all, and this is the way it is, and this is the way it should be for you, you know. Mm-hmm. The end was feeling exactly how I did in the beginning, you know, still curious and still frustrated and still looking for some sort of release, you know.
Mm-hmm. So did you learn a lot about yourself through those experiences or not?
Well, I wasn't really there, so I didn't.
Are you here now?
I am here now.
Good. I'm very pleased to hear it.
Why, Shirley, he's here.
And don't call me Shirley.
Okay.
Okay. Well, we're going to be talking next segment to Mike, and also Jerry a little bit later on. And we've got some goodies to give away, courtesy of Alice in Chains. But right now we're going to show you an exclusive one-off showing of the song we were just talking about. With me on the Headbangers Ball, Jerry and Mike. Okay, Mike, talk a little bit more about you joining Alice in Chains. Have you had to change your style at all to fit in with them?
Oh, not at all. Not at all. I play real aggressive and stuff, and just I've been kind of doing my own thing with the songs. They've been real receptive to it, you know. And a lot of bass chords and stuff, you know, so it's really loud. Really loud.
Loud very works. Nice. Loud works.
Okay, well, we're going to see you in action, actually, live in a moment. We're reaching the end of this special edition of the Headbangers Ball from Frankfurt. When you're actually writing your own material, is it a case of you put on things that really interest you to get inspiration from that, or do you tend to be influenced by the same things?
I don't really listen to anybody else when I write, kind of, because
it
ends up creeping into it, yeah. So, you know, I try to really not listen to anything when I kind of get in that writing mode. And just let stuff come out. It ends up surprising me too, you know. So it's a cool way to do it.
Mm-hmm. I was talking to Elaine a little bit earlier, just going back to the actual vocal arrangements on the album, that they are kind of very, how I would describe, choral. Mm-hmm. We were asking the others if they'd had any formal music training, or you know, how did you approach it? Because it's at first glance, it's actually kind of quite simple, but then you can look deeper.
I don't know, I've never really had much training. I tried to take a couple of lessons here and there. Probably should take about 100 more. I sang in choir in high school and stuff like that. You know, I think most of the stuff that...
Nerd.
I was the nerd.
It's just different to the vocal arrangements on Facelift, so...
Yeah, well, it's a lot stronger. I think yeah. Lane took a lot more...
Peyote?
A lot more peyote.
He got a grip.
Lane did some, did a lot more stuff, you know, a lot more trippy melodies and stuff. I like to call him the human minor bird. He can mimic anything.
Yeah. I mean, obviously you've been doing hundreds of interviews and you've heard people like me giving interpretations of your songs. How do you feel about that? Do you think, gosh, it's amazing that somebody's picked it to pieces like that and come up with that idea. Do you appreciate that?
Everybody's got their own opinion, you know, about what your music is and what it's about. Mm-hmm. I get people that are wrong all the time, and then I get people that are pretty dead on. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just, that's the way it should be. You know, I mean, I think from my point of view and our point of view as a band is like, we made our statement, we did what we did, so, mm-hmm. you know, you can take it however you want to take it from there. You know, I have no concern about defending it or whatever. It stands on its own right, and I'm proud
Absolutely.
Of it. So,
yeah.
So after that, it's kind of just it's up to you. You know, I mean.
I mean, would you tell somebody if they got it wrong?
Well, I mean,
yeah.
It might be right for them.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, if they were asking me a literal question about what it was about, I'd correct them. But I mean, you know, it might be right for somebody in a different way. You know,
yeah.
People interpret songs differently.
I mean, is your ultimate philosophy that as long as you're satisfied with your work, that's all that matters?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I feel an obligation to play the best that I can and write the best music I can for people who want to hear it, but I do those things for myself
yeah.
first.
Is it kind of selfish in a way, in
sure.
that respect?
Sure it is.
But I think you have to be like that.
Yeah, well, I mean, you have to be able to, I think you have to possess something first before you can learn how to share it, you know, and it's got to be happening for you before you can give it to somebody else, you know.
Absolutely. All right then, well, I would like to say on behalf of MTV, thank you very much for giving us so much of your valuable time here in Frankfurt. We really appreciate
Thanks.
It, and I know the viewers appreciate it as well, because we get loads and loads of requests for you
cool.
guys.
Great.
So it's very, very kind of you to take out so much time, because I know you've got lots of other things on the go today as well. So thanks to Lane and Jerry and Sean and Mike Inez, Mike number two, as I do seem to keep calling him. And I want to wish you guys the best of luck with the rest of the tour.
Thanks a lot.